All right, you ready, Nat?
I'm ready. I'll tell you you're ready, but go.
All right, everybody, welcome back. I'm so excited to be with you today. My name is Dr. Jessica Wright, and I'm so happy to be hearing from Natalie Zuniga. So I lead our Office of Academic Development, and Natalie Zuniga is our academic educator. And today is part three of her series on building virtual teams. Hi, Natalie, how are you?
Pretty good. Thank you so much, Dr. Jess. Glad to be here.
Well, great. I can't wait to hear about this third part about building virtual teams and some of the tools that we're going to have at our disposal.
Yes. So welcome back. Welcome to Building Virtual Teams, and I'm so excited. We have been going through this three-prong process. So Dr. Jess, I'll show them, kind of give you a short recap. There was our group dynamics, and we talked about where we are and how groups, they're really trying to find out the boundaries and really establish their group membership and also interdependence. And then we talked also about group formation. And the two, before I go into, just as a reminder, there's two group dynamics on the next slide. The boundaries and interdependence. And then we talked about group formation. So group formation is really, there's two different models that you can use to kind of evaluate how you are currently developing these new teams, if it's not as traditional from that Tuckman's fourth stage of development, and that punctuated equilibrium with moments of change and transitions, et cetera. So next, we're going to be talking about our virtual team development tools. And as always, I like to share, or in our office, we like to have a quote. And it says, when a team outgrows individual performance and learns team confidence, excellence becomes a reality. So when a team outgrows individual performance, and it goes back to that learning how to depend on one another and overcome to make excellence a reality. All right, so based on Hansen's research on taking consideration group development and group dynamics, these are the tools that he says that it's very important to really promote and implement. He talks about promoting trust and group identity and what that really looks like. He breaks all the tools I'm gonna share go into kind of these three buckets. Then he goes into decreasing uncertainty in team processes and what you do, what activities to do that, and then how to manage the distance. Now that we are no longer able to kind of walk, one of my favorite things to do before was with my coworker, Dr. Irwin, was to go to the cafeteria to kind of look at the great soup that they have at Houston Methodist Cafeteria. They have the best seafood gumbo, by the way. And so how can we manage now the distance and we don't have those little moments of life, right? So let's go into promoting trust and group identity. And the first thing that Hansen describes is to initiate team effort with face-to-face communication. It's very important. I know that some of us don't like to use the video, but it also has to be a group effort, right? So meet outside of projects when you're developing. I know we meet almost every day via Zoom, now that we have Zoom or WebEx, but we're also planning in our own team. I see my leader, Dr. Jess, doing this, scheduling times to meet, if possible, and if everyone feels safe, somewhere we can still social distance, but meet for lunch. We call it bring your own lunch at a park or museums or restaurants. And this is still important, even when we can now, even when COVID is over. This is something that for strictly teams that maybe you don't see each other, you are dispersed throughout different cities, or if you're dispersed, in our sense, different entities throughout the community hospitals, it's very important for this to be very common. And because getting together really reinforces mutual commitment within your team and to build that interdependence that we were talking about. However, this should be a group effort. This is everyone plays a role. Maybe you split up the task. Next month, can you choose a place for us to meet? Next month, X, Y, and Z person is going to choose something that you like to do also that we can kind of join in together. It shouldn't be just placed on the leader, okay? But again, this face-to-face interaction really subconsciously signals that commitment on the part of the group members, right? If we're committed to this group, and that reinforcing that mutual commitment. The next thing to build this trust and group identity is to engage in open and regular communication. Open door policy is something very common that we talk about in our organization, but ensuring to maintain that open channels of even remote communication. So whether it's starting to use Microsoft Teams, right, where if they can't text you, if that's not an option for you, someone can send you a chat really quick, and there's that constant ability, as much as possible, still being able to kind of mirror that, let me just turn my chair and ask you a question kind of thing, and whether email, phone, or Zoom. So really support this, and everyone can take their own role. If you find a tool, really share it with your leader that you feel like it works with this, with helping with open and regular fast communication. And you see that it's something, I don't know if it's a GroupMe, I don't even know if we can use GroupMe, but just another tool that you can work for your department, okay? Really share it. The next thing is to maintain space for social interaction. And I know that I talked about the importance of face-to-face communication, but it actually affects kind of the social dimensions of group processes when there's that lack of face-to-face communication. And then informal discussions, the beauty of that, right? So make sure you're booking it within your workload as to have these moments if you have a team that's dispersed. And then inquire, my leader does this, which I was telling her earlier, like, you do most of this stuff. She inquires about teens' lives during our social interaction, and it's very important. I know that you may feel like, oh, it's a waste of time, or if you ever feel like you don't want to touch that side, but it's very important to be invested and interested in the lives of your team members and in their personal lives as well. Of course, if with appropriate, you kind of feel them out and all that kind of stuff. But it plays, what the research shows is that it plays a significant part in effective functioning of the team. When you have that trust and connection, especially if you're trying to build that effective trust that we talked about. And lastly, with the promoting trust and group identity, is address conflict promptly. I like to call this the elephant in the room. That's why that is a zoomed up elephant. I don't know if you could tell, but that is a picture of an elephant. But address it promptly and openly. And we even have classes on conflict resolution if you need kind of some help with this. Again, I know I mentioned this in the last recording. We do have a series, a virtual series on conflict resolution. You can check it out. You should be getting it in the emails, the For You emails. If you don't have access to that link, you can email us to academicrequest@HoustonMethodist.org, academicrequest@HoustonMethodist.org, and I'll be happy to send that over to you. But we also have conflict resolution workshops that you hopefully can join us on. So these are the tips. There's five of them in regards to promoting trust and group identity, and you can take a screenshot of this. Initiate team effort with face-to-face communication, but make sure that it's a group effort. It's not just one person. Engage in open and regular communication as much as possible. Always maintain and schedule a space for social interaction, especially after all of this is done, COVID is done. And then when conflict arises, how address it promptly and openly and effectively. Now we go into this second bucket of virtual team development tools is decreasing uncertainty in team processes. So one of the most significant threats, I think, that some people experience when we go virtual is how effective is it going to function, right? Or there's some uncertainty, and not everyone handles uncertainty equally. So they're worried about, is there going to be less frequent communication between the members? There's potential, like people feel frustrated, there's confusion, there's all these things, my computer's not working, right? So how you can help with managing this is, first thing is apply formal group structure, right? Have a formal agenda to help guide you. Or offer, if your leader doesn't do this yet, offer that. Say, let me develop an agenda to kind of help us with this change that we're about to implement, right? Have clear task deadlines still. I know that when we met in person, deadlines, we don't meet every day in person. We talk things. So have clear task deadlines now. Do task chunking, what I like to call it, is together as a group, say, this week we're going to focus on this, the other week is we're going to focus on this, and then try to your best ability avoid large surprises last minute, because they may not always do well, particularly because we're not in the same room, right? We're not in the same, so handling large surprises is not the same, believe it or not, when you guys are not together in one team. There's something that happens in your brain when you have a challenge or there's something you have to overcome, but you're all together, right? So try to avoid as possible the large surprises. The next thing is establish guidelines for communication and have really clear guidelines, expectations of your modes of communication. So this means if you're gonna use Zoom for, let's say, team meetings, have clear understanding with everyone. Zoom is what we're going to do for this, but then for quick chats for other projects, we're going to use Microsoft Teams. Really have a clear understanding with everyone within the team, within the group, of clear expectations of your choice of media. Okay, this will really help with managing that uncertainty and last minute, like, hey, I'm on this call, but I don't see anybody, right, kind of thing. So really have a clear understanding on what form of media you're going to use or a tool you're going to use for, like, check-ins or to deliver lessons and courses or to send a quick note. It would really help you. I know it seems minute, but it really helps with that anxiety, especially if you're not a fan of technology, right? Okay, so then the next one is promote short response time. Really promote this because we don't have this now. I love my leader. She's always saying, hey, you can call me anytime or text me anytime. Now, if you can't, I know everyone can't always do that, but you can select a norm of response time, whatever that means and works for you, your schedule. I know that everybody's unit runs differently. So kind of sets the time when you're able to respond and make it clear to your team members so they know when they're able to access you. And then prioritize what is highest priority. I know you can maybe feel like you're getting an influx of requests and especially last minute changes. So decide what's going to be the highest priority for you and your work, or if you're trying to learn how to depend on a team member, let's say I'm leading a project with my coworker, then I need to decide what is my highest priority. Increased use, especially when you have an increased use of email and virtual requests. You'll have high inquiries, and then manage those inquiries, okay? All right, so kind of to give you a visual of all the three things to help you decrease uncertainty in team processes is apply a formal structure in your group development, especially when you're developing new groups for a short amount of period of time. Let's say for the next 3 weeks, I'm working along unit or with this arm of physical therapy. Really have that clear structure. Establish guidelines for communication, and again, promote short response time if possible. Now the last one is two short answers on how to manage the distance. And the first one that he showed was experiment with technology and really be open with the different forms of technology that are out there if you see something that you think will really work for your team. So in addition to email and video conferencing, find what works within your team. And again, this should be a team effort. Ask them, hey guys, are you aware of something that you think will help us with being collaborative? Find virtual collaborative workspaces like a whiteboard, an electronic whiteboard, and I think Microsoft Teams and has this option. It's actually a really, really neat tool. I really look into Microsoft Teams. We're using it for stuff now for our classes that we're going to be teaching. There's a whiteboard. There's ways to share files pretty quickly and really take advantage of those collaborative workspaces. And again, it should be a distributed effort. It's not just for just one person to be responsible for. And then the last thing is establish a facilitator role. This is going to be really helpful with managing the distance. So though naturally everyone looks maybe for the leader, but establish different facilitator roles to help you, to help for the success of the team, right? So you'll have somebody who's responsible maybe for solid schedule and agendas for team interactions, or they're the person, you have one person that's going to be handling maybe mitigating uncertainty for the department, or going to be taking notes, those kinds of things. Find out different roles that everyone can be a facilitator role or own, if you will, during this time of virtual team, for your virtual teams, to foster engagement and commitment from members as well. So it kind of helps. There's a facilitator role also, like helping group manage the mix of technologies and communication channels. You just need one person that's going to send out, let's say, all of the WebEx meetings, and one person to really lead in Microsoft Teams. Those kinds of things will really help manage the distance and the frustration maybe that would come with trying to manage the technology. So I'll end, obviously, with the next step. And really evaluate. I know I kind of gave you a huge list of different tools that you can implement or to be aware of. So think about what virtual team development tools you will implement or you feel like they're great, so you can kind of suggest to your leader that will work for your team. And it was a pleasure being here with you. And if you have any questions, always reach out to us to academicrequests@HoustonMethodist.org.
Natalie, thank you so much. I think, you know, one of the things that you said that was, you know, that you found in the research that was just really on point was about making sure that suggestions and, you know, comments and ideas of social interaction, they're coming from everyone, not just from leadership. One of the things when we talk about change in the next series, we're going to have a 3-part series on change. And one of the things that's really important is that change be an organic thing, because it is more, you encounter more resistance if change comes from top down. So if the boss is saying, okay, everybody, we've got to do it this way, it is, you know, encounters more resistance than if one of the team members says, here's an idea, let's do it this way. So I love that. And you've given me some really great ideas for our team as well. We have just today we finalized that we're going to be meeting, bringing our lawn chairs and our coffee on Friday mornings to go sit in the park, 6 feet apart from each other, wearing our masks and sipping our coffee. So as our way of being able to be physically present. So thank you so much for this, Natalie. I appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. Thank you so much. I'm really looking forward to Friday, too.
It's going to be good, I think. All right. Bye-bye.